I chose this difficult title, What is Consciousness and Could Machines Have It? I'm going to, in this talk, try to convince you, first of all, that we have growing knowledge of what happens when we become conscious, at least of a small piece of information in the outside world. And so, in the first part of the talk, I'd like to say that I think the problem of consciousness has ceased to become insurmountable, and in fact, we have many ways to ask about the objective brain mechanisms, even for subjective processes, what I call the signatures of conscious processing. And I will argue that consciousness is one aspect of a computational system, so it does not need to be implemented in specific brain tissue. It's a computation, and maybe we can reproduce it in machines. So at the end of the talk, I will speculate about what it would take. I would just like to say that I think one of the difficulties is that there are many different meanings of consciousness. And so here at this slide, I was trying to make some basic distinctions. The first one, I think, is we are now completely accustomed to the idea of information processing without consciousness in algorithms, in our machines, starting with Turing and Shannon. We know that information can be processed mechanically. And so there is a whole level of unconscious algorithms, and the research in human subjects has showed very clearly that there is a lot of computation that can occur without consciousness. Then I will argue that there is a first level or a first definition of consciousness, which is conscious access. It seems that the brain is able to take a piece of information which it finds relevant, to amplify it, and make it the focus of additional processing. And that is computationally useful to dedicate resources, central resources, to a specific object for further processing. And that's what I call conscious access. And then the second level is conscious self-representation, I think something that is much less studied, but not unstudiable, as we just saw, where the system represents itself, knows that it knows, knows that it has made an error, and so on and so forth. So I want to start with a very simple illusion. I think many of you know this work by Ted Edelson. I think it's very beautiful. You don't even see that there is an illusion the first time you're exposed to this. But if your attention is drawn to these two cells and you mask the rest, you can see that they are the same exact luminance. They are identical. And yet, when you see the whole scene, it's impossible not to see that one is a dark square and one is a light square. And what's going on, of course, is that there is the presence of this dark area, which is interpreted as a shadow. It's nice, it's compatible with the presence of this cylinder and light coming from the right, so it's a good interpretation of the scene that there is a shadow. And if there is a shadow, the visual system is trying to let you see the luminance of objects in the absence of the shadow, so it's subtracting the shadow, and that's why you see the shape light in one case and dark in the other. What I like also about this example is that I think that anybody who would want to build a computational vision system would build it in this way. So a computer would fall to the same exact illusion that we have here. It's a rational illusion. And illusions tend to be rational. They are inference. They are unconscious inference. But another aspect of this illusion is also that it must imply that there are lots of computations before we become conscious of anything. We are conscious of the result. We are not at all conscious of the complex computations of detecting the shadow. We may not even be conscious of the shadow at all. Of course, there has to be probabilistic computations, subtraction operations, so on and so forth. So this is a general idea that we found in many experiments, perhaps all experiments on consciousness, is that there is a lot of brain activity which can occur in perceptual areas for a long time, at least 200 milliseconds, sometimes more, that is completely unconscious. We're not aware of it. But then there is a second wave of activity that correlates with conscious reports. And it tends to be long-lasting neuronal activity of all or none nature, non-linear, ignition, style that integrates the incoming signals and decides that there is an object that's worthy of conscious access. So this is essentially the strategy that has been used to study consciousness, to pick illusions of this kind. We've used a lot masking, where you flash a shape, and if you follow it by another set of shapes, like the letters here, they mask the initial digit. Or inattention is another case, where you distract the subject temporarily. Maybe there is a first letter. If you attend to the first letter in a stream, you are unable to see the second one. It's called attentional blink. And with these paradigms, basically, you can make something conscious or unconscious at will. And you can see that these paradigms really focus on this notion of conscious access, a sort of minimal version of consciousness. The questions of self-consciousness, attention, vigilance are all different questions. This is really about a basic aspect of conscious perception. One aspect also of this research is that it relies heavily on introspection. In fact, introspection is what defines, eventually, whether consciousness occurred or not. So, rather than introspection being a wrong device for psychology, introspection plays a central role, but only as a report by the subject, not, of course, as direct access to how the system works. We don't have direct access to how the system works, but the subject defines whether he has been conscious or not. So, one of the best experiments is to have stimuli that are strictly identical, but they are at threshold level, and so sometimes they are conscious and sometimes they are not. And I will show you experiments of this kind. And I think the fourth ingredient that has really revolutionized the study of consciousness, the ability to directly look at the brain with all these techniques, in particular intracranial recordings now, I'll show you some experiments, where you can discover signatures of consciousness, so objective correlates of subjective processes. Already more than 15 years ago, we started to do these first images. We found what I think is one of the basic findings, is that whether you present visible versus invisible words or sounds that are detected versus non-detected, you find two things. On the right side, you can see that even invisible objects can create, unconscious objects can create strong brain activity in specialized brain systems. For instance, the visual word form area that you see on the top right here, this system is specialized in recognizing written words, orthography, invariant for font or size. All of these computations occur unconsciously. Even access to the word's meaning can occur unconsciously. For instance, the amygdala has the emotion for an invisible word. We don't see it on this image, but it can be activated invisibly. But what you also see is that when the word is visible, there's an explosion of activity. There's amplification of the processors, and there's also access to a whole array of additional areas in frontal cortex in particular, frontal and parietal areas, that come online together and accompany the sense of being conscious. We can study that with better methods like intracranial recordings to follow the activation in time. So when you do that, you have access really to millisecond resolution. What you see is that for a non-conscious versus conscious word, they all start, as you should expect, in the occipital cortex and basically identical levels of activation. If you measure later in time, like at 200 milliseconds, you see that you begin to see the divergence, but initially it's just a sort of continuous difference, a difference of quantity, not quality, where the activation becomes stronger as if a sort of snowballing effect for the conscious case, whereas it's staying in the system, propagating a little bit, but being of lower amplitude in the case of the unconscious word. And finally, you reach this late stage activation where the activation has snowballed, self-amplified, and we have few electrodes in frontal cortex in this study, but you see that they suddenly become activated quite late, and there's no trace of such activity on the unconscious case. So it's late, discrete activity that seems to be a discrete marker of conscious access. It's also in the same intracranial studies and also in EEG studies, it's the synchronization of these activations and the fact that the activation returns in a top-down manner, which are signatures of consciousness. So it's not just that we have enhanced activity and access to frontal cortex, but there is synchronization in the long distance, and it's much more higher amplitude, and Wolf was alluding to this long distance synchronization in his talk. We see that when it occurs late, after 300 milliseconds, this long distance synchronization is much more characteristic of visible as opposed to invisible situations. There is also long distance causality and a top-down return of the activation from frontal to visual areas. This long-distance synchronization can even be measured in a resting state without any particular stimulus, and the amount of information which is being exchanged at a long distance is a good marker of whether a patient is still in vegetative state or has moved to the minimally conscious or conscious state. So it's just a very short note to mention that these markers are strong enough now that they can be used in the clinic. They are not perfect, they are not quite on a single subject basis, but they are statistically quite able to discriminate conscious from non-conscious patients. In fact, spontaneous activity is sufficient to discriminate conscious versus unconscious situations, so we don't really need to stimulate the brain in order to see markers of consciousness. A conscious brain is characterized by so-called resting state patterns of brain activity. And as you can see on this slide, if you compute this with a sliding window, what you do is you compute the correlation between activation in different areas of the brain. So you get these correlation matrices where red indicates strong correlation between activation in two areas and blue indicates negative correlation, that is to say one area is active when the other tends to be inactive. You see that these patterns constantly fluctuate. The rate is never at rest. And what we have shown is that it's these fluctuations, the fact that the brain will spontaneously explore different long-distance functional connectivity networks, which is a good marker of consciousness. So there has been some confusion in this area because some of the long-distance functional correlation still exists in the anesthetized state. And people have said, oh, resting state networks exist in the anesthetized state. But what we find in this paper with Pablo Bartfeld and Mariano Sigmund and others is that the connectivity becomes more static during anesthesia. It's the same matrix. It ceases to change. And the matrix begins to resemble just the anatomical connectivity. So what happens is the following. There is an anatomical connectivity matrix. Even when you're anesthetized, there is still random spikes circulating through this matrix, and that will create a first form of functional correlation, which remains even during anesthesia. But there is a second form, which you see here, of functional connectivity, which is constantly changing and seems to reflect the subject's mental goals and mental activity, will correlate, for instance, with self-report of having mental imagery or being mind-wandering or other mental states. So it's this long-distance late networks that seem to correlate with consciousness. It's possible now to go even to single cell or spike correlates of consciousness. So this is an experiment that Peter Rofsema and his colleagues did, and I was associated with it, where the monkey is the subject of study. The monkey is fixating, and we flash a stimulus, which can be in the receptive field of the neurons being recorded, and or there can be no stimulus at all. And the monkey has to decide to report, basically, on a subjective basis. If he thinks there was no stimulus, he makes a saccade to this so-called rejector. If he thinks that there was a stimulus, he has to make a saccade towards the stimulus. So we have a report on the part of the monkey, whether he saw or did not see the stimulus. And you can see that just like in human subjects, we have a threshold function as you manipulate the contrast. There is high visibility condition, intermediate, and low visibility condition. What's great about this paradigm is, again, you can sort the single trials based on what the monkey reported, seeing or not seeing the stimulus, even with a fixed stimulus. And when you do this sorting, you can now measure the correlates of activation in area V1, V4, and in prefrontal cortex. So each line here is an activation. And I think you can immediately see that in early visual areas, the activation segregates primarily by the objective stimulus. It's present, and even if it's seen or missed, you get this activation. If the stimulus is not present, you get very low activation. But you can also see immediately that in prefrontal cortex, it's the contrary. You get late activation, which is highly dependent on what the monkey reports. And transiently, it cares about whether there was a stimulus, but then it diverges and seems to simply reflect what the monkey has been subjectively reporting. This experiment is great because you can tell why the stimulus is unconscious. If it's a very low visibility stimulus, so this is a low contrast stimulus here, and it's a fixed stimulus, you can see that already in V1 trials where subjects report, when monkeys report seeing, are high, and trials where you will report not seeing are low, and the transmission failure seems to occur at the level from V1 to V4. V1 can be active by invisible stimulus, but V4 is not, or very little here, and there is no activation in prefrontal cortex on this invisible stimuli. If the stimulus is more intense, you can see that the failure can occur later in the system. So it's beautiful to see the red curve here is a stimulus that the monkey will report as invisible, couldn't see it. But it creates very strong activation. Activation can be even stronger than for the low intensity stimulus here in this left column. So you get this very strong activation by invisible stimulus. But what's occurring is a failure of transmission to the prefrontal cortex. So once again, it seems to be the accumulation of evidence in this late network here that slowly ramps up and eventually creates this all or none divergence. We've called this ignition. All or none divergence to two completely different conclusions. You can see that even on false alarms, where there was no stimulus at all, but the monkey erroneously concluded there was a stimulus, this prefrontal cortex network converges to the high state of activation characteristic of conscious perception. So I just want to mention that all of these data, they're beautifully regular curves. They are very easy to capture, actually, by simple networks, cascading types of networks. So we simulated here a sort of very simple feed-forward network, but also with self-connections becoming more and more intense as you go higher in the hierarchy, so creating longer duration states, and with feedback. And you can see that this network reproduces essentially all the curves I've just shown you. One aspect which is interesting is if you look carefully back at these curves, there is a little bit of late amplification on conscious perception state. So it's not just that the prefrontal cortex diverges, but it sends back some activation that creates a subjective state also perceptible in early visual areas. So it's a reverberating state, and it's in this model, it's these strong connections between parietal and frontal areas descending back, which creates this all or none divergence. It's a nonlinear system that ignites or does not ignite. Conscious ignition has been measured at the single neural level, and I think we understand better what it means now. During all sorts of paradigms, if you record from single cells that care about one specific stimulus, for instance, in the anterior temporal cortex, Rodrigo Quillan Quiroga has found cells that care about a specific person or a specific place, like the World Trade Center, a concept cells. Well, these concept cells will fire quite late, after 300 and 400 milliseconds, and they will fire only on trials where subjects report seeing the image. If you flash the image, if it's masked, such that some trials are invisible, like the red trials here, there is no firing. There is firing only when the subjects report seeing the stimulus. It's important, therefore, that these cells are specific to a particular stimulus, but only in the conscious case. So you have to imagine that for every concept that we can be conscious of, there is a subset of cells. It's not that ignition is igniting the whole prefrontal cortex. It's that there is a subset of cells that can be ignited, have the content of consciousness. Same experiment here with ambiguity. So this is a morph of, it's a horrible morph, I think, of Bob Marley and Whoopi Goldberg. I don't know if you can see that. This is just at threshold, and if the subject reports seeing the stimulus that the cell prefers, which is Whoopi Goldberg, the cell fires. If with the same exact stimulus the subject reports seeing Bob Marley, the cell does not fire. Another example in prefrontal cortex now, where the same exact thing happens in the monkey, in Nikos Logothetis' work with Panagiotaropoulos. So here the same exact stimulus at the end, and if the monkey reports seeing the monkey face in this case, that's the preferred stimulus for that cell will fire, otherwise it will not fire. So single cell correlates of consciousness here. So this is my way of summarizing this data. It's what we've called the global neuronal workspace hypothesis, and I think it's a functional hypothesis for what might be going on here. First of all, there are many brain modules, especially in the visual system, that process information locally. They are specialized. They are unconscious. information progresses through the system, but what we subjectively experience as consciousness is the higher states of global availability of information. There is a system of long-distance connections, including prefrontal cortex, which holds to the information, even if it was flashed, it can keep the information, and this system will allow to report, memorize, use the information flexibly. It's what we call the global neuronal workspace. So this is a useful system of higher level resources that cannot do many things at once, but can dedicate their entire resources to an object that has been selected as relevant. There was discussion about what can be the function of consciousness, and I think with this analysis we begin to see a bit better what is the function of consciousness. So some people said, well, consciousness is too late. It's 300 milliseconds after the fact. It's after a lot of computation, so maybe there is just an epiphenomenon of consciousness. But I think we know it's not the case now, and we have a whole list of operations that depend on becoming conscious. One of them is reflection, long-term reflection. Subliminal information is always decaying quite fast. It can last for a few seconds, now we know that, but after a few seconds it's very, very low, low signal to noise. Consciousness affords high signal to noise information. We can reflect for minutes on this information, even longer. It discretizes the information, so it's no longer probabilistic information, it's samples that are discrete, all or none, and can be therefore reported in a compact manner or stored. The information can be routed through multiple processes. So if you try to do a chain of calculations, you have to use this consciousness system. It's an empirical finding that if you ask for chains of calculation, unconscious information cannot go through a long chain. So this is a router system. And one aspect also is to monitor our own behavior. So 300 milliseconds is actually quite short. After 300 milliseconds, we begin able to look after the fact, see what happens, and detect our own errors. So what I'm showing you here is a system for error detection, which has been studied in the brain. This so-called error negativity, which arises from the anterior cingulate frontal areas, and which will be triggered whenever you click a button and you know you've made an error. You click and, you realize I shouldn't have been doing that in these psychology experiments. Well, we've been doing this paradigm with stimuli that are flashed, so that half of the time they are seen and half of the time they are not seen. And what you see in the bottom is that you get this error negativity only when the subject reports seeing the stimulus. So you are able to tell that you make an error only when the stimulus was conscious. What is happening here is that when the stimulus is conscious, you have a notion of what you should have been doing. You are conscious of what you should have been doing, and you can compare with what you have actually done, which is unconscious, so which can be unconscious. So you have an ability to decide that you have been making an error. You don't have that when you have an unseen stimulus. The list could go on. For instance, the sharing of information to other subjects is, of course, one important property of becoming conscious. Becoming conscious allows you to report the stimulus to others, and Chris Frese, for instance, has been arguing that this is a major function of consciousness in humans, that we are able to achieve collective decision-making. So I want to conclude my last few slides by asking how we could put this in machines. What is missing from current machines? So the first idea is this global workspace idea. If you look at, for instance, an iPhone, it's full of very useful apps. They are quite intelligent. Why is it not conscious? Well, one idea is that an app has a lot of information, but it's modular. It's all encapsulated. It's just like these modules in the brain. We might be missing a blackboard, which allows the apps to share the information, to tell each other that they have the relevant information. If we have the system that was able to say, I have the contact for a person, you don't have to retype it in another application, I think this would be closer to a system that is that has the human form of consciousness, to make the relevant information known to the whole organism. So, we could discuss whether that's already in some systems or not. This idea of blackboard architecture is an old idea in computer science. Well, I think if you want this to work, you have to have something else, which is a repertoire of self-knowledge. You want to have a system that doesn't just know about its body. I think, in fact, here the body is almost immaterial, but it wants to know what apps it has, what talents it has, what sort of knowledge each of these systems possess, what goals they can fulfill, how fast they can operate, how likely they are to be correct. All of this information is self-knowledge information that, in fact, human subjects have. So there are beautiful experiments, for instance, in the domain of arithmetic, where you can see that children choose how they are going to make a certain computation by memory, by counting on fingers, by using paper, and so on. They decide what they are going to do based on a sort of mental statistic of what has worked in the past, how fast it was, did they get the correct result. They have a repertoire of self-knowledge. And I think this is something that a machine could easily have as well, a way to route the information based on knowledge of its own abilities. The complementary to that is knowing that you don't know and having a sense of confidence about what you think you know. So there is a growing evidence that in humans there is a system quite early on, this is in 20 months old babies now, for metacognition that already knows that it doesn't know. One way to show that is young babies will ask their mother or ask a helper who has the information only in cases where they realize that they don't have enough information. So I think we could put that in a computer system. We've discussed yesterday about just Bayesian programs or probabilistic programs that don't just give an answer but actually have the probability that it is correct, and so maybe could realize that it's high probability that it's not correct. But I think also the error detection system that I just described in humans could be put in machines that constantly predict if their current behavior is likely to be wrong and take corrective measures. It's very important that this error detection system in humans is not just there to detect errors, but actually is coupled to the executive control system so that on the next trial, you regain control, you change the strategy, and you have a higher probability of being correct. So I think this would be a machine that turns into itself, compile statistics of what it knows, but also detects when it deviates from the correct behavior. Finally, the fourth point is that this system that is turned onto itself should also be turned onto others. And there is evidence also in humans that knowledge of oneself and knowledge of the others could be operated by the same theory of mind system. So we need to represent not just what I know, what others know, but in humans perhaps specifically we have this ability to say what I know that others know, what I know that others don't know, what others know that I don't know, and so on and so forth. And this is the basis for teaching, for instance, where I know that you don't know something and I know how I could perhaps change your state of mind and teach you something. A machine, I think Josh came very close to that yesterday, a machine that simulates other minds and simulates what other minds represent, including other minds, would be a machine that would be much more relevant. And I think this issue of relevance is a key missing aspect of current machines. So we all have GPS devices that guide us today, and they take us to a roundabout, and they say, take the third exit. And the third exit can be just in front of you, in which case it would be much more rational to say, go in front of you. Or sometimes can be the third exit is on your left, so you might just say, take the left. So I think what we need here is a machine that would simulate the user, know what the user knows, not what the user sees, knows how the user might fail, so realizes that the user may take the wrong exit if you don't give a more precise instruction in some cases. A simulation of the user is, I think, one thing which is clearly missing in current machines and would bring them closer to consciousness. I think I'm going to skip that slide because it's a bit late. Or maybe I have time to show it, Wolf? It's late. Terrible. So no, I think I will just stop here and just show you the faces of the people who helped me do this work. Thank you very much.